There's no reason, geologically or otherwise, why there couldn't be well over 100 miles of cave under this mountain. In mountaineering terms, we could well have an Everest on our hands.
God, Daren Cilau, that's a terrible place. The worst cave I ever had the misfortune to go into in the first place.
Nature's not going to beat me, I'm going to beat it. You don't give up. You just keep on and on and on and on.
The discoveries that have been made in Daren Cilau are the finest in the British Isles. But the most exciting thing is that we don't really know the ultimate extent of the system.
Bill Gascoigne, lecturing chemistry at a technical college. Clive Gardner, film editor, currently out of work. John Parker, fitter at an ammunition factory. Martin Farr, instructor at an outdoor pursuits centre. They have one thing in common, their obsession with the mystery of Llangattock Mountain. Llangattock stands on the northern rim of the coal-rich valleys of South Wales. The mountain was first penetrated by cavers in 1946. They discovered a cave they called Aganathweth, the Keyhole Cave. The gate was built across the entrance to control access. The gate was needed because so many lost and exhausted cavers had to be rescued from the 20 miles of passages. Almost inevitably, a caver was killed. He was a diving companion of Martin Farr's. Despite that tragedy, cavers knew they'd have to follow the water to find the missing links of Llangattock.
In 1976, in this particular area, we had a very bad drought. The Welsh Water Authority asked me if I would do some dye tracing for them in the area of Minas Llangattock to try and identify water supplies. Fluorescein is a water-soluble dye. And it's just introduced into streams which go underground. It is then absorbed by activated charcoal in the springs where those streams reappear. It's relatively harmless. And it's a very, very highly coloured dye. It can be visually spotted. If you're lucky enough to be in the area when the dye comes through, all your problems are solved. But this is a very unusual occurrence. So that the general way is to put little bags of activated charcoal in as many springs as you can find in the area and analyse the bags in a laboratory by treating them with a mixture of chemicals which will extract the fluorescein back out of the bag. When the fluorescein is extracted, usually it's plainly visible. The green colour can be seen coming from the charcoal. Dye tracing the streams of Minas Llangattock gave the first indication that Aganathweth was not the only cave under that mountain. Prior to the dye tracing that I did, it was thought that Agi, as it's known, could well be the only major cave under the mountain. But it became very obvious early on that many of my dye traces were getting through the mountain without going through Aganathweth. So it helped to point cavers towards looking for the other caves. When the whole mountain's cracked open, I'd be surprised if there was less than 100 miles of cave.
The caves of Llangattock were formed by water from an ancient river Usk. They were literally underground streamways through the limestone rock. They emerged to the southwest in the Clydach Gorge. As well as Aganathweth, there's Eglwys Vain, Daren Cilau, and Craig y Ffynnon. four caves or just one vast cave system? It's that mystery that had preoccupied Clive Gardner. He'd even given up his job to move to South Wales, but he failed to find the missing links. He turned to Daren Cilau in a last effort to break through. The entrance had been dug out back as far as 1957, but it was so daunting, few cavers ventured in.
The first time I went into Daren Cilau was 1982. The worst cave I ever had the misfortune to go into. It was around about summertime, far better being outside and sunbathing, I think. But I went in with Simon Edwards from South Wales Caving Club. Now, this chap was really young and fit. He was probably only about 17 years old. He was a very good climber. We were going to look at a lead in the cave, which we thought would go. Well, to cut a long story short, it didn't go. It was absolute horrible carrying with all this tackle that we had to get in through the entrance series, and we swore never to go back again. Simon never went back, and I went back with two friends from Chelsea Speleological Society in the August Bank Holiday weekend, 1984. The routing through the entrance series turned out to be worse than I remembered it.
The entrance series of Daren Cilau requires a unique kind of masochism. It's like doing 10,000 press-ups on one arm while inching forward for over a third of a mile.
I noticed this hole behind the boulder, which appeared to have been unlooked at and completely untouched by any human presence. As I crawled on down the passage, it started becoming obvious that there was more than just a dead-end alcove here. There was a very strong draft, a cold cave draft coming out. Now, anyone who goes cave digging knows that the best possible sign you can have to show that there's larger cave passage beyond the cave that you're already in is a strong cold draft. The boulders looked precipitous. They were about sort of looking rather like pincered guillotines, except they would just crush you instead of chop you in half. And eventually, we found our way down into a little chamber. And from this chamber, I dropped stones down and heard them rattling down a calcite slope into a big chamber below. Well, we knew we got something, but it might well have been a dead end at the bottom, but the draft seemed to indicate it wouldn't be. I went round to Martin Farr's house. I felt that really we ought to invite him in on what looked like being a potential discovery in Daren Cilau. I'd already had two boulders fall on my head. They'd only been small boulders, but I'd been sufficiently unnerved by all the digging work that we'd done over the successive weeks that I was quite happy for Martin to pull out the remaining half dozen boulders.
No one had any real idea where any way on was likely to lie in Daren Cilau. Clive had found it, but Clive lacked the, well, possibly the nerve to push it through to its total conclusion. Anyway, Clive had found this very, very loose boulder choke and invited me in to find if this boulder choke was possibly negotiable.
For Martin Farr's close friend, Arthur Millett, it appeared as if Llangattock Mountain was about to yield its innermost secret. He and the others had explored the mountain for years without being able to turn exactly the right key. They'd always been stopped by a barrier, water filling the cave ahead, a roof collapse, choking the passage with boulders. And that's what lay ahead in Daren Cilau.
All right, it's not like
you both fit to move?
When you look at a boulder choke, it's like a big game of chess, except that if you make the wrong move, you know, you're not just going to lose the game, you're going to possibly lose your life. You work out, when you're looking at the boulders, just which boulder's going to move and what consequence any one movement will have. You try and think, well, is it worth trying to push yourself into that particular tight spot? This particular choke, well, the gap there that I eventually squeezed through was about 7.5 inches high. Extremely tight. I mean, you had to totally breathe out
and slightly, well, it really was a tight and very committing move. But once down through, you could see there was a big tunnel leading off, and we were all set. I got through the choke in total ecstasy, wandering down this virgin extension. There was no other word for it. It was absolutely incredible.
It's getting worse and worse.
Into the wet one.
No swimming now. Take it easy.
It was over 2 kilometres anyway of open passage we just walked into. At the time, we really thought we were going to drop into Craigiefern.
The cavers laid tapes as soon as possible. The tapes are a guide, but more importantly, they help to preserve the cave floor and the remarkable formation that Martin Farr and his companions discovered.
Must be something like aragonite or something in the, mixed in with the calcite to produce those characteristic shapes.
We'd seen things like the White Company before in Craigiefernan. To be truthful, we passed the White Company the first day. We looked and we thought, God, that's fantastic. But we passed it by almost in a blasé manner. And the most important thing on our minds on that particular day was possibly breaking into Craigiefernan.
A link with Craigiefernan would have been further proof that they were exploring just one massive cave system. But Daren Cilau itself had more surprises in store. They discovered formations unlike anything they'd ever seen. They called them the antlers. They seemed to point onwards. Craigiefernan was in fact just 150 feet away, but the rock was unbreached.
Lots of the other formations in the cave, but it must be the largest in the country.
Under the mountain as a whole, all of us in this room tonight would agree that the most exciting thing is that we don't really know the ultimate extent of the system. To my mind, we have no idea what lies to the west. There are miles and miles and miles of cave that lie to the west of the boundaries of Aghanapwydd and Daren Cilau. Bill is currently involved in a mega dig in a place called Carnow Adit, and he's having a considerable degree of success there. John is involved in another dig, apart from his digs in Craigiefernan, further west in the mountain. And he's found well over a kilometre of cave there. In Daren Cilau, well, we're still mopping up, and all, obviously we hope to connect Aghanapwydd and Daren Cilau.
I think, Martin, to say mopping up in Daren Cilau is a total misnomer, because there is, in fact, a major cave system from Eglis Vine Daren Cilau.
Now, not to Daren Cilau, right the way underneath.
In the middle of the mountain, you're talking about 3 kilometres... of large fossil passage, which is probably the most spectacular sort of passage to discover, and that's still waiting in a small section of the mountain.
Another piece of the Llangattock puzzle had begun to fall into place in the late 1970s. A storm led to a landslip on the escarpment. It revealed the entrance to Craigiefernan. A small group of cavers, including John Parker and Anne Franklin, has carried out a remarkably single-minded and systematic exploration. It's taken them more than 10 years. Their exploration caused bitterness and controversy. To protect their discoveries, they've barred access to all cavers except those they personally approve. Craigiefernan has proved a jewel in the mountain's crown. Almost from the entrance itself, the formations are extraordinary, both on the cave roof and on the floors of the passages. There was more to the cave than the formations. They discovered the biggest cave passage that had ever been found in the British Isles and called it the Hall of the Mountain Kings.
Thank you.
The efforts of John Parker and his companions to protect their discoveries by restricting access to Craigiefernon are constantly under attack. And the attacks are not only verbal. On one occasion, the gate to the cave was broken down and some rock formations destroyed. On another occasion, the lock of the gate was superglued in protest. And it's not just a hooligan element that's critical. Experienced and respected cavers disagree vehemently with the Craigiefernon policy. They include some of those who've opened up Daren Cilau next door, a cave without a gate.
The discoveries that have been made in Daren Cilau are the finest in the British Isles. I mean, there has been no attempt to prevent any access whatsoever to that cave.
But you've got a natural...
Yeah, you've got a natural hazard.
No.
You have?
You've got a natural hazard.
Yeah. I mean, a caver's got to be pretty proficient to go through the crawl in Daren Cilau to start with. I'm pretty experienced. You're not going to get novices going in there.
I think to understand this attitude, you've got to have found good passage. Once you've found good passage with good formations, you do become very protective of it, and rightly so, because once it's gone for good.
And in many respects as well, the first time you walk up a really beautiful passage with your friends, you have that feeling that you want to keep it all to yourself as well, so that no one else goes there and ruins it, so that it remains just as it was. And that, I think, is pretty important.
Well, the thing about caves is they're not regeneratable. I mean, if you walk a mountain bare of grass, then all you do is stop walking on it and the grass grows again. But if you walk a cave bare of formations, you've walked it bare of formations, and that's the end of it.
And that's the end of it for 10,000 years.
And I've got to give it to John. His approach with Craigiefernon has protected the place.
No better than Daren Cilau.
Daren Cilau will have to stand the test of time like Craigiefernon has. So, you know, you've got to give him his due. I don't agree with all his views, obviously, but it seems to work.
The formation called the Pagoda is a measure of the success of John Parker's policies. 10 years after it was discovered, it's still in perfect condition. Close by are even finer formations.
Well, this passage has been closed since 1978, and the reason we closed it off with all these fine formations was to protect it. Not even ourselves, we don't even come up here for digging or anything. We surveyed it, photographed it, and we completely left it as it is. But if cavers came up here regularly, all this, due to wear and tear, would probably become destroyed, it'd become dirty, the dust off the clothes would contaminate all the formations. A lot of it is so delicate, if you practically sneezed on some of it, it would fall off. You just couldn't let the passage of cavers up here to completely ruin it. We have let the occasional photographic trip into here, but, you know, what the discoverers, you know, it's the delight of the discoverers to find it, you know. You just can't see it ruined after. It's got to be kept. You only got to see this. You know, this is, well, it must be important in geological terms, let alone anything else, you know. But it's actually a mixture of aragonite and calcite with some gypsum crystals thrown in. And that is pretty rare, and it's just fantastic, you know. To see this ruined, it'd be criminal.
If Clive said he'd just found a connection between Daren Cilau and Craigiefernon, what would you say?
Let's blow it up. I don't know, really, because if it was a very difficult connection, I think I'd probably leave it.
But if it was very easy and I thought the cave was going to get ruined, I'd have to conserve the cave and I think I'd probably blow it up.
Take in. That's me.
Climb in, Renee.
Climb in. These ladders are taking a bit of a battering.
Well, they've been here a few months. So, let it change the fuel over.
She really swings around a bit, this ladder. Come on, beat them muscles up, Arthur. That's better.
In most caves, the way on lies downhill, but in Daren Cilau, deep under Llangadog Mountain, the way ahead was up in the roof of a cathedral-like chamber. The cavers managed to free climb the cliff face carrying a ladder. They attach this to a bolt at the top and lower it so that the others can follow and the exploration continue.
Just coming over on the ledge. Right, going up the second half.
Hey.
Climbing again.
Talk, me want some slack?
Yeah, nearly there. Right, just coming over the top. Okay, I'm at the top. Slack!
Daren Cilau's reputation was growing, but what they found next surpassed the scale of anything they expected.
Can you shine that light up? There's a nice big hole in the roof here. No, that one closes down.
Which one out?
I'll climb up on top of the boulders and let them see it from a different angle.
Another one up there we can have a look at.
Yeah.
Let's move a bit closer.
It was a passage bigger even than the Hall of the Mountain Kings in Craigafunnan. It made them all realise just how fleeting and insignificant their own presence in Llangadog Mountain really was. They call the passage the Time Machine.
I'll move around, perhaps I can see better into the...
Yeah, move a bit forward.
Hold on where you are there, Arthur. Right. Flaming hell, this stuff is as loose as hell underfoot. Flaming quarry in the dark, innit?
So you can give a couple of quarry owners a field day down here. What do you reckon up there?
Oh, that's a good end. Is there a hole on this near end? Come over this side of it.
Quite a long passage.
Well, what was the surveyed length of this place, then? The time machine?
500 yards.
A quarter of a mile.
Yes, very, very big.
Daren Cilau was now so long and so demanding that to explore the remoter recesses needed new tactics.
Yeah. considerably too far to reach the most distant digging sites and out again without sleeping. And as soon as you're talking about sleeping, you're talking about getting dry, and you're talking about eating. Really, this is quite new as far as British caving is concerned. We deliberately try and make it as morale-boosting as possible, and that means the little touches, inevitably. I mean, that's the whole idea of the stereo and the games and the novelties and what have you. Great fun. It's a lovely place to come. We like caves with beautiful environments. They're a wild place. There's all that sort of freedom that goes with the natural environment. We refer to it as the great indoors. And it actually takes as long to get from the surface to the camp as it does to go by plane from London to New York. And the psychological distance is easily as far.
Break those bits out. A lot of this is loose. Some of those ones under you should come out now, the crowbars here.
Yeah, it's pretty solid at the back here. It's all loose. It's drafting up the hole to the right there.
That's terrific. Yeah, yeah. I can actually see little motes of dust in my light drifting back towards me. The very fine stuff that you're raising. Yeah, there's definitely a draft there.
To go there and to work hard with your arms, digging for hours, 4, 5, 6 hours. And then to know that you've got all that trip out with all its more interesting aspects, the crawls, obviously, the ankle grinder, acupuncture, hard rock sections, yeah. Very hard. And the entrance crawls, very hard.
Yeah, solid wall on the left there. Oops, boulder's gone.
Oh, good. Oh, I'm glad we spotted this hole.
Where we've been working is the frontier. We'd like to connect to Aganathhead next door, or perhaps to Craigiefinnan in the other direction. If we could connect to Aganathhead, we'll have the longest cave system in the British Isles.
Everything the cavers take into Daren Cilau is eventually carried out, and it isn't simply to preserve the biological regime of the cave. They're also trying to maintain a familiar, secure lifestyle in what is a dangerous and alien environment.
In most fields of endeavour, obsession, a little touch of obsession is essential to success. You've got to be a real enthusiast or you'll never, you know, make the top. It's not that we want to make the top in terms of being sort of better than other people or getting our name in lights, because obviously in caving that's not really what happens. It's a question of succeeding for yourself.
I think we've drank most of the booze.
We think of ourselves as explorers. We camp every day, we go off digging. It's like a day out from the camp. As a method of applying man hours to the dig, it's fantastically successful, not least because you don't have to persuade the team not to leave in time to make the pub, because the pub's there in some form or another, at least the comfort is.
There's a lot of the chocolate bars.
Is there any cheese there,
Is there any cheese, Lutch? Yeah, I think it's got a little cheese.
The small familiarities of life help to keep minds and bodies normal in the abnormal environment. The sleeping area is a few minutes' climb away from the main camp.
It's this way, Pete.
Oh, OK.
Right. OK. I lost.
Yeah, looking
forward to the next morning. Got the warm packs going as well.
Sending me in.
It's the nearest place they can find with a sandy floor, which borders on being comfortable. But the sand does get everywhere. It is vitally important to get sleeping arrangements right in the cave. They spend up to 10 days underground. There's no dawn, there's no dusk, so the human body clock tends to go haywire unless they follow a strict timetable. It's almost like jet lag. To fight it, they sleep from midnight to 8 in the morning. And the system seems to work.
Oh, God.
There's nothing that compares with the thrill of breaking through into undiscovered passage and There's this pristine floor stretching away, no footprints. You know, yours is the first light ever to shine there. Yours are the first eyes ever to see this. And you look, and it's a black hole, and you can move off into it. And the unknown, and it may close down there, and the next corner, it may go 3 miles. That's an incredibly exciting experience. Something you can easily describe. That's the real thrill.
We're learning about the planet's past, which is also hopefully going to tell us something about the future.
Yeah, it's also one of the true forms of exploration left on this planet. It's the deep ocean abysses and inside a cave. You're the first human being to set foot in there. You're also the first human being ever to see it. And to all of us who have experienced that, it is an absolutely mind-boggling experience.
That's a wonderful experience.
It's incredible. It's
John said it's a drug, and it is. Cavers fall into two categories. There are about people who go caving for about 3 years, and they do all the tourist trips. And then they pack it in. And there are people who, in that 3 years, actually find something. And chances are they're hooked for the rest of their lives. It's probably, if you like, religious. I don't know, I'm a totally irreligious person, but there's a great feeling of awe about it. And you're hooked.
Makes you feel rather small as well,
doesn't it? And is it?
I think what's happening nowadays, certainly in the 1980s and perhaps into the 1990s, is that caving is becoming the area in which new exploration is possible. All of the great peaks of the world have now been climbed, and the climbers are looking for different routes, harder ways of doing it with or without oxygen. What cavers are looking at is making new discoveries, original discovery, where no person has ever been before. And I think that's the thing that's most exciting about caving, and caving in this mountain at the present time.
Joe Brown said it all, and I've forgotten exactly what he was. He was probably on somewhere halfway up K2 or something, having a hell of a problem. And he said at that time that things like mortgages and overdrafts and things like that seemed totally insignificant in comparison with the problem he had on K2. And I think we all feel, I mean, caving's far more important than whether you can pay the next bill or whatever. Certainly in my life, I tell you what, I'd rather find 200 meters of brand new passage than win the pools any day of the week.
It's precisely that kind of enthusiasm that's led to the most prodigious effort yet to break into the heart of the mountain. In Craigiefunnan, John Parker and his companions found a side passage off the main route. It was blocked. But undeterred, nearly a mile inside the mountain, they began to tunnel their way through a massive boulder choke.
Well, this actual tunnel has taken me 4 years, with four of us to take this to build, three times a week. It represents quite a lot of work to us. It's about 200 feet long, and it then ends, and then the railway actually ends then and carries on into a boulder choke, which carries on for another 150 feet. We know which way to dig. We follow the draft through small little gaps in little pebbles and boulders. We're hoping to dig through here and find lots of new cave, possibly 15, 20 miles of cave. I don't think it matters if we've connected with Daren Cilau. What I really want to find is lots and lots of brand new cave.
Yeah, if you leave her out behind,
you
get to hold that down. That's done a good job, isn't it?
It's all
shattered. Al, can you come up and get the other truck?
I'm digging now. Gosh, it was all easy, wasn't it?
Yeah. So it makes the change from mud and slag.
I think what it is, you put so much work into something that you just can't stop. You know, you just can't let that work just go to waste. You can't give up. So you just got to keep on going, because you've got to have faith in what you're doing. But eventually, one day, you will break through.
Parker's highly individual views about the control of Craigafunnan are being put to the test. A management committee has been set up to regulate the exploration of Llangattock Mountain. John Parker is a member of the committee, so is Martin Farr.
I'm sure that now that we're all members here, just about, of the new Mynydd Llangattock Cave Management Committee, that that John will obviously see fit to let us into digging Craigafunnan. I mean, there's no barrier to that.
I don't think there's any chance of that, Martin.
But are you saying then that the diggers in Craigafunnan are superior diggers to the diggers in Daren Cilau or elsewhere?
No. But if you want to dig something, I think you should find your own dig.
In fact, in Daren Cilau, there were many potential routes still to be explored. Any one of them could lead to the elusive breakthrough. But the risk of an accident was increasing. Clive Gardner believed that every time a caver went into Daren Cilau, he was taking a bigger and bigger gamble with his own life.
The amazing thing about Daren Cilau is that there hasn't been an accident since the original breakthrough in 1984 that a person hasn't been able to bring themselves out of the cave on their own. So what we're really waiting for is fate to catch up with us and to take out one or two people. There's absolutely no question that the Gwent Cave Rescue Organisation can bring you out on a stretcher or drag you out. If you're unconscious or unable to move, then there's almost no possibility of your getting out of that cave alive.
But there was another potential route to the surface, straight on through the mountain. In the remotest part of Daren Cilau, the waters of the cave collect in a pool, the terminal sump. This water flows out to the surface in the Clydach Gorge. Dye tracing showed it flowed out through a pool in the riverbed, 60 feet deep and choked with boulders. The cavers built a dam. They wanted to clear the boulders and force a way into the underwater passage. So far, they've failed. But at Elm Hole nearby, divers did find another way into the same cave system. For Martin Farr, it was to represent the ultimate challenge. Farr made a series of dives into Elm Hole, laying a guideline as far as he could get each time. He then did the same through the terminal sump of Daren Cilau. In the murky waters, 600 feet beneath the mountain top, he connected the two lines. He could now attempt an epic journey right through the mountain.
Anyone who's anybody who's behind me, you know, with the draft is going to really cough it.
The day he chose for the attempt dawned miserably.
Yeah, okay, we'll keep going then.
Is that it then?
Yeah.
Okay, follow Steve. Right. Yeah, okay.
For a week, cavers had taken in the equipment he needed, setting up a base camp at the terminal sump. Now they were going in again to try and ensure that nothing went wrong. Martin Farr has long been one of the leading cave divers in the world, so there was considerable media interest.
Martin.
Morning, mate.
Hello. You're about to make one of the most dangerous cave dives in Britain. Are you feeling confident?
Very apprehensive, but I think once we get down there and if everything looks okay, yeah, I'm pretty confident.
Can you tell me a bit about the dive itself?
The dive is about 630 metres long. Getting on towards half a mile, it certainly feels like half a mile when you're underwater in there. The visibility is normally about an arm's length, 2 to 3 feet, and the depth goes down to 70 feet. But the worst part of the dive is at the very end. I mean, right at the very end of the dive, 3/4 an hour after starting, I'm going to come up against a vertical squeeze that's just a foot wide.
What about you yourself? Because once you're down doing that dive, what's going to happen if anything goes wrong with you? Can you be rescued?
No, that's it. I mean, I'm absolutely, totally self-reliant. There's nothing I can do. I mean, that's why I'm carrying 4 bottles. I mean, I've got plenty of reserve of air should anything go wrong.
your best friend and your partner actually died doing a similar sort of dive. Didn't that hold you back from taking this on?
Well, obviously, you've got to weigh things up very much more carefully after something like that. I mean, it's a very, very serious thing. So, I mean, I've weighed the odds. I think I can cope with it all. And my friend, if he was around today, would be giving me every support, I'm sure.
What will it mean in caving terms once you've actually completed this?
Well, it'll be one of the most significant developments, most significant events in Wales, certainly. It'll be the longest and the deepest caving through trip in the British Isles, and one of the hardest in the world. And as far as I'm concerned personally, it'll be a lifetime's ambition achieved. I'll be very, very happy indeed.
Well, we look forward to seeing you out the other end today. All the
certainly,
best.
I will too. Thanks.
Right, see you, everybody.
Hello.
Right, cheers, then.
Cheers.
Oh, I'd never get back.
Martin Farr went into Daren Cilau at 9 o'clock in the morning. Ahead of him was a rigorous 8-hour journey to the sump, one of the most difficult and hazardous caving trips there is, and that before the unknown dangers of the dive.
Don't tread in the water, that's good lads. No, I speed up a little bit.
He arrived at the sump on time at 5 in the afternoon. His major worry was underwater visibility.
It's all okay here now, isn't it?
Just before 6 o'clock when he dived. Visibility was poor because heavy rainwater had run off quickly through the peat which covers the mountain. His life hangs literally by this thread. Without it, in the poor visibility, he'd become lost. But the line itself can be a killer if it becomes entangled in his breathing equipment. That's why he carries a knife to cut himself free if necessary.
Thank you.
waiting here at Elm Hole in the Clinic Gorge. Any moment now, Martin Farr's due to come out of that crevice over there. No idea if he's okay or not, because we haven't been able to get in touch with the crew or the cavers for the past 9 hours. Two divers have gone down to help Martin through that tight squeeze at the end of the sump. All we can do is sit here and wait.
Martin Farr has long passed the point of no return. In the icy water, his hands are becoming numb. It's increasingly difficult to hold on to this lifeline. Visibility is getting worse.
Thank you.
Can you speak?
The first time in an hour, yeah.
Jane's here waiting. She's gone to get you a can of lager. You'll be able to see her in about 2 minutes.
Well, my throat's unbelievable. Even though you've been underwater for an hour, I mean, my throat is just absolutely parched.
How was it?
Horrendous.
Has he been out?
Horrendous. No.
What?
Just now.
Yeah.
The visibility is the worst I've ever had, I mean, in any British dive exploration. It started off at an arm's length and it slowly receded until it was just there. And it just got worse and worse, and then suddenly I reached the worst bit, the bit I was absolutely dreading, down at Elm Hole, which is the notorious tight bit where there are several sections that wide, and the worst section is just big enough to squeeze through with everything around on your side. And then suddenly a little miracle occurred, all the water got clear, I could see past my fingertips again. So I was able to jettison the two empty tanks that I had, the two emergency bottles that I was carrying on my back, so I breathed those out first. And unencumbered then, I could just get through with just two of these on. I mean,
was there a time that you thought you might not make it?
Until I reached the Elm Hole window, I mean, I was really shaky, but fortunately everything just went like clockwork, and here I am.
I would like to see a connection between Agonoth with Daren and Craig Fenner in the next 6 months. The distance between Agonoth with and Daren Cilau now is somewhat less than 250 metres. I'm quite confident that a physical connection can be made for all cavers and without having to dive, and it only needs another one really lucky trip to connect Daren Cilau to Craig Fenner.